All right, what's up, everybody? Welcome back to another video. So we're out here, we're in the forest. We've got Crystal with us today.
Hi.
And we are bringing back the Q&A videos. So a lot of you guys might remember them being called Ask Me Mondays. And we're just gonna bring them back as Q&As because when I get pressure of putting up a certain video on a certain day of the week, sometimes I get a little stressed out and then I don't do it. We really want to start doing more of these though, because I think it's really important. People have a lot of questions, right,
yeah.
Crystal? And what I've noticed lately is I've been watching and listening to a lot of videos that are more conversational, because I like to listen to them when, you know, I'm out like walking in the forest like we are now sometimes, or if I'm like doing dishes, cleaning up around the house, whatever it might be. It's just like so nice to listen to people on YouTube talk about, you know, other random stuff. So that's why I really want to bring these videos back. I'm sure a lot of you guys feel the same. So don't worry, there's still gonna be lots of like recipe videos and full day of eatings and stuff, but these will be nice to just, you know, sit back, put your headphones on, and just take a walk through the forest with us and just hang out and listen.
I'll be asking Derek the questions. If you guys have any other questions, leave them in the comments below and we'll be sure to answer them in upcoming Q&As.
Exactly. So before Crystal gets started with this, we are in a super beautiful little part of the trail right now. You've actually never been on this side of the river?
No, I haven't.
So we usually do, we've done a few Q&As over on the other side of this river, but this is the first time that Crystal's been over here. I was here the other day exploring and I thought it was really cool. So I thought we'd come here and answer some here. But first, let's just show you guys the view from here because it's so cool. So I don't know if you guys can see, it's pretty far away and this camera doesn't zoom very well, but there's people like on that rock right there that's like hanging right over the river.
This is gonna be really busy in the summer.
Yeah.
Like this is where everyone comes to swim.
Yeah, this is such a nice swimming hole. So another nice part about these videos is that we get to show you guys this amazing, beautiful place where we live, because we know it is like a really unique place. We have so much amazing nature around us. So for anyone asking, we live on Vancouver Island in British Columbia, Canada. So there's actually a cave right here, which is really cool. Man, I'm showing you guys like all the cool nature-y stuff like right off the bat. I'm not gonna have anything for the middle of the video, but I feel like this would be good for like rock climbing. Actually, let's try it out. That.
Where are you gonna go from there?
This is it. It's just I'm just practicing my holds. I'm sure a real like rock climber could have some fun in here though.
Oh, for sure.
We're gonna sit down for the first question. Crystal said it's gonna be hard on my brain.
It's a good one, but we're gonna, you know, have a little conversation, right?
Yeah, no, we're gonna.
It's hard to do that in the forest when you're walking. So the first question is by Lou Kulele. I like that. Random question. How much does variety matter? If you skillfully devise a few meals that meet your calorie, macro, and RDI needs and eat these same meals every single day, is there something wrong with that?
Right. Okay, cool. So I would definitely say yes, there is. And I'll tell you why. And I learned it from Dr. B, who is the author of Fiber Fueled, which is an amazing book. If you guys want to learn anything about, you know, fiber and the microbiome and how important it is to our overall health, definitely read that book or listen to some of his podcasts. He was actually just on a Ritual podcast. Well, not just, but I think he's been on there a few times, but one of his most recent ones was just so amazing. And he talked exactly about this. And he talked about how the greater the diversity of the foods that you're eating, the greater the diversity of your microbiome.
Mm-hmm.
And this has been well studied. I think it was the Hunza tribe that they studied this in. And they just found that they eat such a wider variety of foods than we do here in North America. They found that they actually had 40% wider variety of microbes in their gut than we do here. And that's of beneficial microbes. So what he said, the benefits of that is that your microbiome is then a lot more robust. So it's not as sensitive to getting thrown off kilter, you know, with little things like maybe, I don't know, maybe
if you're eating certain foods or something you're not used to, your body's just like, oh, I got that. Because you have so many more like microbes in there that can deal with that.
Yeah, and pathogens as bacteria, all that sort of stuff. So definitely I'll put a link down below to that exact conversation, and I'll even like timestamp it to the exact point, because it's like amazing how eloquently he states all of that. But yeah, it's true. More diverse the foods that you can eat, the more diverse your microbiome. And every single plant has individual fibers in it that other plants don't have, and they're gonna benefit a certain microbe or certain types of microbes in your gut. So yeah, definitely variety is definitely good.
There's ways of working around this. So for example, if you're making like a lot of like lentils and rice, you know, for the main bulk of your dish, and then you're having like some greens or some you know, sweet potatoes or something on the side, then maybe every week or two, you know, change it up, like eat different vegetables with that meal,
right.
Or, you know, try a different variety of lentils, or maybe try a different, you know, type of rice or a different legume or something like that.
Right.
So instead of, you know, every single meal being constantly the same for weeks and weeks and months, you're, you know, you might be having the same kind of foods like lentils or whatever legume, but you're kind of like changing it. You know, there's so many varieties of lentils. I mean, we've only tried like a handful and there's so many. Same with beans.
Yep.
And a lot of them have very similar nutrient profiles, so you can like change them up. Same thing with like vegetables, especially non-starchy vegetables. You can eat just so many of them. They're so high in fiber. They're so micronutrient dense, but changing it up is so great. So one week you could have, you know, a lot of carrots, the other week red cabbage, for example. So that's kind of a way that you can kind of create variety, but also, you know, use foods that you're kind of used to and you know the macros and you're, you know, you're getting your micros and all that kind of stuff as well.
Right. So you're saying you don't have to like create like all new recipes like all the time.
No.
But just like do some simple substitutions.
So hopefully that answers the question. That was like a really great question, I feel like.
Yeah, that was a really good question. I was happy to see that one. Oh my gosh, I gotta show you guys this. So just walking along the sand and we see this poor slug. Well, actually, he looks like he's doing okay because I'm pretty sure he's eating this. Okay, do you have another question ready?
I have another question.
Should we stop okay. So you don't trip?
Yeah, stop so we don't trip. This is from Cameron Suter. He asks, I love how honest you are with cooking. I feel like a lot of YouTubers would only show perfect meals, but it's refreshing to see you describe dressings that don't immediately work. Seaweed tasting meh and textures sometimes being mushy. I love cooking, but having perfect meals every day, and it's affirming to see how you show plant-based nutrition in a realistic light.
Nice. So yeah, it is important to show the reality of it. Like not every single recipe comes out. And I think this was from the last sauce video that I did where I like blended up a date pit into
oh,
the
yeah.
sauce. But yeah, I mean, that happens sometimes. You got to roll with the punches. And I know it is tempting because I'm like, you know, I have the power of editing to just kind of like make things seem perfect. And I did think about, oh, I'll just throw this away. But no, that is like the reality of it. And sometimes you just gotta, you know, work with it. So yeah, sometimes things are a little bit mushy, but you know, usually there's a way to save it or at least make it taste good enough that it's edible. But yeah, you're totally right. And I think we do have to remember this when we are watching many, you know, content creators that
yes.
it is, you know, quite highly polished a lot of the time. And not to say that mine isn't, you know, I don't show necessarily like my most unhealthy meals because I like to motivate and inspire you guys, but I just show you the reality of what I eat most of the time. And I don't always love the taste of seaweed. I get date pits in my sauces sometimes. It happens. But you know what? For the most part though, Crystal, I mean, my cooking is generally pretty good, I think.
Chef's kiss is amazing. Even that sauce that Derek made with the date pit, he was like, oh, I don't know. And I tasted it. I was like, I can't even tell. It's delicious. I'll eat it all.
So anyways, yeah, thanks so much for that comment. And I do appreciate you recognizing that, you know, real eyes, real eyes. So you guys will notice not all of the questions are actually questions. That was a statement or an observation. And we're going to include some of those as well. Just stuff that I think would lead to like good conversation
yeah.
and good dialogue and, you know, just things that I want to highlight. What's the next commonly asked question or statement?
The next question or statement, which is actually, it's another statement. It's by Inferno. And they ask, you have no idea how much your food videos help me with my vegan protein anxiety. Which I think is a thing that a lot of people probably struggle with, right? Protein, protein, protein.
Yeah, it certainly is. I know. So yeah, that's great. That is why I love showing, you know, the reality of what I eat in a day and why I love filming those full day of eating videos, because it gives you a good perspective into what it looks
yeah.
like from day to day. Like, you know, it's easy for me to put up a video that's like super highest protein, like spaghetti bowl ever, and get lots of clicks on it. And everyone's gonna be like, yeah, oh yeah, I gotta eat all this protein because, you know, that's what these recipes are all about. But, you know, that's not really how I eat and I don't really think about it all that much. But I do wanna say that you do have to consider protein a little bit, especially if you want to build muscle. So
yes.
I think there's definitely like the two extremes that we hear. We hear that, you know, from much of like the bodybuilding sort of side of things, you hear that you need so much protein and you just can never get enough and any extra amount is like even better, you know? It's like you want, they want you to get like a gram per pound of body
yeah.
weight at the least, you
yeah.
know, is what a lot of people say. But then on the other side, there's a lot of people that, you
that
know,
are like, don't worry about protein. Just yeah. like, you just eat, I don't know,
whatever.
Lettuce and
you'll
yeah. get enough. And you're like, what?
Yeah, so
like, that's not true.
You'll get enough to live
yeah,
for sure. You'll
maybe.
Get enough to stay alive. And I mean, maybe not just lettuce. Well, if you ate enough calories, I don't know. I'd have to check that out. But no, I mean,
but who's gonna eat like, yeah, Yeah, no. Exactly. It's ridiculous, you know?
But, you know, as someone who, if you are trying to build muscle, yeah, you do want to think about eating some higher protein foods throughout the day, but you don't have to sit there and, like, obsess about protein.
But even if you're not trying to build muscle, you should still be getting, like, you know, higher sources of protein throughout the day as well.
Because those foods are super helpful, so like good. Beans and lentils and quinoa and hemp seeds and tofu and tempeh. So anyways, yeah, that's about it on protein. Just wanted to touch on it really quickly because we're always getting new people coming to this channel, and the protein question is one that just continues to come up. So I just wanted to touch on it a little bit in this video. So don't worry about it too much. Just worry about it a little. Man, this is so beautiful here. Like, so I don't know if you guys can pick up what we're walking through here, but with the sun the way it is, man, I'm just gonna put the camera this way. You guys don't want to see my face. This is way better. Man, this is some Jurassic Park stuff out here, hey?
Yeah, I'm waiting for a velociraptor to just come out of nowhere.
Alright, man, we're getting into the thick of things. Like, I think the trail is ending.
Alright, so the next question and or statement.
Okay.
I don't know, this is kind of just a funny kind of like hater comment that we just wanted to highlight a little bit because it's just ridiculous. Oh, yeah. So I don't really know how to pronounce his username, Stavati. They say, modern vegans just eat processed fake garbage. It's actually hilarious they crave meat replacements.
Oh, it's so funny. Why is it hilarious? Okay, first of all, you must be new to the channel because I don't eat just like fake junk, you know? I would say that we primarily eat whole plant-based foods, but hey, whatever. Like, if you want to do that, that's your, you know, your own dharma. But I also want to say, we didn't become vegan because we, or at least for me, because we hate the taste of meat or because we hate the taste of cheese or eggs. It's not why we became vegan. There's a lot of reasons why we did, but that's not one of them. So it's like, well, why can't we have some food that's shaped into a patty or like, you know, some tofu egg scramble or something like that might resemble egg. Like, why not? I don't see what's wrong with that. I don't know. You guys will have to let us know in the comments down below, like, what you think of that. But I always think that's a funny argument when meat eaters are always like, oh, why do they always have to make it taste or look like meat?
It's so, and then I always wonder, like, who made you the gatekeeper of what I can eat?
Yeah.
Like, why are you trying to gatekeep my diet? Like, just leave me alone. Just let me enjoy my food and you just do your thing.
You do you. And then a counter argument to that, though, what I want to know is why do meat eaters always try and get their meat to taste like vegetables, constantly putting spices on there, you know, garlic powder, onion powder, paprika. Look what's in steak spice. It's not steak, it's spice, it's vegetables. Okay, so that's what I want to know. There's my question. From now on, you're not allowed to put any herbs or spices on any of your meat or products or anything like that, and I'll stop, you know, whatever, calling mine meat. It'd be fun to come here and have like a little forest picnic one day or something. I don't know. Yeah, except for when the cougars get wind of like the delicious food that we have.
Yeah, tofu, just like.
I know, all of our meat flavored plants.
Okie dokie. Next question. I don't really know if it's a question, kind of a statement, but it's just something really good to talk about.
Do we have any questions in this one? Who is picking these?
So the next topic we are going to talk about is from No BTS, and they say, stabilizers and preservatives aren't necessarily bad. Sucks to hear this idea pushed forward, but I understand just wanting whole foods. However, stabilizers and preservatives aren't inherently flawed, unless it's, well, toxic to human health. But for example, citric acid is a normal stabilizer and preservative used.
Right. So fair enough. This was pulled from my last video where I was showing how to make some sauces in the kitchen out of common ingredients that you probably already have on hand. And I mentioned how it's great to learn how to make your own sauces because you can control what's in them. And a lot of the time, store-bought sauces are full of a bunch of preservatives, stabilizers, refined oils, sugars, and that sort of thing. And this person left that comment. And I would have to agree. I mean, for, you know, I wasn't trying to demonize them or anything like that, you know, but I just think that it's probably better if we don't have them. Like, is a little bit of citric acid gonna be harmful to you? Heck no. I mean, we know that's just like vitamin C, but there's others, you know, there's maltodextrin, there's all the guar gums and all those sorts of carrageenan and all those sorts of things. And it's like, yeah, sure, we could talk about the minutiae and the details on each one, but if you could make your own food and it doesn't have that in it, it's probably going to be a better option. So that's all I was trying to get at. But I agree, I eat some foods that have those things in them some from time to time, but I just try not to, you know, consume them more often than I need to, really. So anyways, I just wanted to throw that in there because, hey, I appreciate you guys keeping me on my toes. And if you don't agree with something I say, put it in the comments down below and I'll put it in a video like this and talk about it. So I was actually reading an article recently on nutritionfacts.org, and I'll link it below, on maltodextrin and how it is actually really bad for people with Crohn's disease. Mm-hmm. And yeah, there's some technical way on what it does, and I don't quite remember right now. If I read it a couple more times, I might. But I'll link that below. So anyways, you know, something that might just be totally fine and like not harmful for some people might be bad for others. So anyways, just throwing that out there. Yeah, Crohn's, maltodextrin, stay away. Look at the link below. It's an article. Man, I love it in here. I feel so good when I'm in the forest.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
I just feel so alive. And the temperature right now, like, guys.
It's like, it's actually just perfect.
Yeah, it feels like just we're in like a biodome, you know? I don't know if you guys remember that movie with Pauly Shore. Oh my gosh. But yeah, it feels like just, the temperature's like just skin temperature out right now. Like I can't even feel the air.
No, you can't. It's so
good. Oh my gosh.
So, last question. And this question is from Alicia, and she says, I'm so confused on how to eat. Low carb, high carb, low fat, count calories, don't count, macros, low fruit, low sugar, make sure I get enough protein as I work out every day. I'm so scared. Lots of carbs will make me gain weight. My mind is spinning. Any advice would be appreciated.
Right. Okay, wow. So yeah, there's a lot going on in that comment there, and I totally get it. Like, if you are not alone, in fact, you are probably the average person feeling that way. The amount of like misinformation that's out there and the amount of confusion that people have around diet and nutrition and everything is just like mind-boggling, and I feel really bad. And that's why we're doing what we're doing though, right, Crystal? Because we want to set the record straight and we want to show people that it doesn't have to be difficult. There aren't any crazy secrets. There isn't, you know, a magic pill. And you know, you can just look at the magazine covers when you go through the till at the grocery store. Especially like I feel so bad. There's like some, you know, some like bikini model, and it'll be like, oh, I avoided this one food for a month and got this body or something, you know? And it's such a lie and it's such garbage. So I totally understand that, but you really have to get away from any of the sensationalism around it, first of all. What's important is that we eat whole plant-based foods. And of course, this is why we eat this way, and this is why we promote the eating of this way, because we see it work for so many different people. And it's not difficult once you start doing it, right? Like, you don't have to worry about eating too many carbs, because the whole food, plant-based carbs that you're eating on this lifestyle are so good for you. They're so filling, so full of nutrients, and a lot of them are actually associated with weight loss. Black beans being one of them, one of the best foods for weight loss. And there's 75% calories coming from carbs, you know, and it's a great plant food to be eating. So yeah, I get it. I get the carb phobia. You know, we shouldn't be scared of foods, but we do want to try, especially if we're trying to lose weight and get some of our health back, we do want to avoid like processed carbohydrates. Yeah. We want to be avoiding, you know, just like the junk. You know what it is. The, you know, the
Chips, the candy, the cakes, the dessert, basically everything not in the produce aisle.
Yeah, totally. But I feel for you. And I wish that there was a way to get this, you know, information out there broader. And I wish that people could understand that once you start eating whole plant-based foods, things start to fall into line. Like you start to, you know, get to the proper weight, whether you need to lose weight or gain weight, you know, provided you're eating enough calories. Yeah, it's really amazing. You know, if there is a magic pill, it probably is a whole foods plant-based diet, but it's not going to be overnight or anything like that. In conclusion to that question, you know, we feel you. You know, especially Crystal as a girl, I'm sure she understands more than I all like the fears and everything that there is around foods and certain types of foods.
Yes, it's very difficult. This question's hard to answer because there's so many things that intertwine, right, with this. Like, it's not just like the food labels. It's like the actual fear of food, the fear of gaining weight, the fear of, you know, body image.
That's a big one too.
There's just so many fears that go into like how we eat, and we're just all conditioned to just be so scared of food.
That's another thing. A lot of people's health or decisions on food are based on vanity. They're based on the fact that somebody might want to lose weight, or they want, like, whatever it might be, they want to gain more muscle. And so all of a sudden they're eating tons of protein and they're trying not to eat like any carbohydrates and stuff. But it's like, that it doesn't always equal health, and a lot of the time it's not going to. So we just have to remember that, you know? Anyways, that's enough rambling for us today. I hope you guys enjoyed the Q&A's coming back. Like Crystal said at the beginning, if you have any questions that you want answered in one of the upcoming ones, please put them in the comment section down below. So thanks so much, Crystal, for coming, hanging out. Always appreciate it. And it's always so much more fun for me when you're out here with me. And you always add so much value to the questions. I know I'm always the one, you know, I kind of hold the mic, but you know, without you, there's a lot that gets missed. So I really appreciate you being out here. So anyways, we're back here at the car and we're gonna go home, get some food. So we love you guys. Thank you so much for watching. See you soon with another video.
Bye.
Bye. And this is one of my favorite little spots around. There's this like huge rock. You can climb right up it.
Wow.
And you get this amazing view of the river.
It's so calm.
Yeah, it is so calm.